those in place. Some owners feel that they are damaged anyway, and insurance policies are part of the program, and those usually end up dealing with it.
Thank you, Tom. I would just ask that the abutter, I know we've asked in the site walk for communications between the applicant and the abutter, but I would ask the abutter to state specifically for the applicant what issues the applicant should be aware of in terms of potential impacts on the site. As Judy had said earlier, this is an RC zone. The applicant has a right to certain development within the ordinances, and if the applicant proceeds and gets approval, then fully they will be building on this property. But I think it's your responsibility to advise the applicant of any specific concerns that you have, and they have to be specific. They can't be general regarding a horse, or to allow the applicant on the property if blasting is required to videotape and record that information. I don't know how, otherwise, how we can keep this process working smoothly. Certainly look for the applicant to do that, and I hope that the abutter is willing to work with everyone involved. Are there any other board questions or comments? Do I have a motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I'll propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Regosa Corporation for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Wild Rose, a five-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Route 77 and Spurwink Avenue, be tabled to the regular June 1993 meeting of the Planning Board.
Is there a second for the motion? Any discussion? No, the only item that I can think of that hasn't been discussed is the issue of the performance guarantee and the estimate of construction. I assume that that will be forthcoming with the next application. Yes, Judy?
I would just comment that you had mentioned that you would be looking for the applicant to be installing all buffering and fencing and so forth.
That's correct.
And I would agree with that, and that the performance guarantee should be set accordingly.
Okay. All those in favor of the motion? It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Much, Tom. And before we, real quickly, before we go on to the next agenda item, I want to just make something very, very clear. When I said we were lucky to have Tom back, it was no reflection on Judy's job. A month ago,
I forgot the same Judy.
I saw her eyebrows go up when I said that. There was no reflection there. It was just Tom has been away for numerous months on some personal, professional responsibilities. And the last time we only had three board members, and Judy did a great job. Before I get myself deeper in trouble, we'll move on to the next agenda item. Highlands subdivision amendments request by Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the previously approved Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channel View Road, subdivision ordinance section 16-2-5. If the applicant or representative of the applicant could come to the podium, see Mr. Frinsco here, if you could very briefly, and I know you're capable of briefly bringing the concise points to us as to where we left off.
Chairman, I'd like to bring the board up to date on where we are. And perhaps the most helpful way to do that would be via the memorandum submitted to you by the planner. And let me just handle the items one by one. With regard to the right-of-way and easement deeds, as you know, from off-the-record comments, I've been discussing this with your town attorney for some time, and we had received previous approval on the form submitted for the acceptance of the first road. Ironically, I submitted to the town attorney the identical deed that was submitted for the prior acceptance in the subdivision. And the response from Mr. Hill, which you should have received a copy of, indicates that he wants me to add two words to the deed with warranty covenants. I have no problem doing that whatsoever. It's just, I find it interesting that change has been made this time. And he recognizes, as do I, that until the final plan is approved and recorded, the surveyor really cannot draw the deed descriptions. And he states in his letter that once she has accurate legal descriptions, I'm confident that the deed will meet with our approval. So I believe that's been satisfied, and you can check with Mike on that to satisfy yourself. As to the format and terms of the deed, he has no comments at all. He's satisfied with them. He does, of course, before this goes to the town council for acceptance, he will want to review and compare the descriptions against the plan, as would I. And that will be available as soon as it's done. DEP approval. As you know, when we came before you at the last meeting, we had been promised to receive from the commissioner a site location order approving the amendment. As is typical, it wasn't received, and after a lot of prodding, at 16:44 was a quarter of five this evening, the DEP faxed to us the signed site location order, and I'll provide copies to you, Mr. Chairman. In brief, the department has approved the amended plan as submitted and as is pending before your board. I should alert you to two things in the order. And those are a requirement by the DEP. I can make more, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to give you what I had, and I
just had to instruct him
to
share.
My machine broke after I got through three. The DEP site location order has required the developer to proceed immediately with two aspects of the plan. And the first is to implement the wetlands control and protection measures immediately because of the growing season time. And the second is to install a locked gate blocking access to the emergency access road. I just want to alert you and anyone else who may have a concern that in view of the order, that work will commence and will proceed in compliance with the order. The third comment, I'm not sure I understand. A plan delineating the areas in the wetland restoration plan has not been submitted. I have to assume that that came from the comments of, I wish I could read his name, but whoever submitted the letter on behalf of Mr. Morin, who says no plan has been submitted. On February 11, 1993, a complete narrative restoration plan together with plans showing the location of the areas was submitted to the town. I'm uncertain as to why that comment came through from T.Y. Lynn staff. Mr. Swan is here and has a copy of that plan. It should be part of the application package, and it would be helpful to me to understand what it is that's missing, since this hasn't arisen before. The contract with the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation monitoring and reporting on the restoration process has been submitted. We had hoped to have that contract in a type form, but we can't force Mr. Cutlass to do it. He has given you his contract, breaking down the work, setting forth the costs, and the applicant has accepted that monitoring responsibility. We understand that Mr. Cutlass is acceptable as a monitoring agent in this project. The fifth, the performance guarantee. You should know that there is already in place a performance guarantee for this subdivision, the form and content of which have been approved by the treasurer and the town attorney. The function of the planning board, as I understand the ordinance, is to set the amount and to set the time of the performance guarantee. In this particular instance, the performance guarantee relates to assuring that the wetland restoration plan will be completed. You have been given a breakdown of the cost of this. We would hope that you would accept the cost, and you also have a cost for Mr. Cutlitz to monitor this. This would be merely an amendment to the existing performance guarantee in place. Now, with that, if we can answer any further questions, or if I haven't been clear in my presentation or any information you have not seen, let me know, and I'll try to assist you and use this time at least to be informative.
Okay. Mr. Frinsco, two items. Number one, I have to appoint Peter Cotter as a voting member.
I understand that.
Number two, with a consensus or the agreement of the board, I'm going to suggest perhaps we take 3 to 5 minutes and let the board members read this.
Yeah, I just barely had time to do it myself.
I was trying to read it and listen to you at the same time. I think it's a central document to what we've been waiting for in this process. And
right.
If we just have a chance to look at it, maybe we'll have some
I can tell you, questions. I've reviewed it. Mr. Swan's reviewed it. We believe we understand it, and we will give, if you have questions, we give you the benefit of what we believe it to say and mean.
Is that okay with the board members to just, if we quickly peruse through that? We'll take about a 3-minute break and return to order. Thank you.
I can translate the, this came through the department's fax, Mr. Chairman, and if you have a problem, I think we can translate anything that's here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'd like to bring the meeting back to order. And while I give Maureen about 15 or 20 more seconds to, I'm going to have Maureen review the important salient facts of the letter from the DEP, I just want to remind the applicant that this is an abnormal procedure where we take an item from the applicant the night of the agenda item and take action or utilize that information in our discussion. Is simply it's not an effective way to carry on a planning board meeting.
Mr. Chairman, nothing in this process has been normal, so I
understand.
I apologize.
That. We all understand that,
department.
And certainly we're not putting the blame on you, Mr. Frinsco.
I'll be glad to accept it, however.
Beside the fact it's a difficult fax to read.
I know. I called.
Had a chance to take a look at it.
I called and I was told what it said, and I can only relate to you what I was told.
Okay.
If you have a question.
No, I will like to have Maureen go down through the important issues in the communication. If there's some discrepancy there, Mr. Frinsco, we can discuss that, and maybe you can help decipher. There's a couple lines in there where you have to use your imagination as to what it actually says. Maureen?
Just going through it very briefly, it appears that the first requirement of the DEP is that the wetland restoration plan submitted January 20th and supplemented March 30th be implemented as soon as possible so that it can take advantage of a long growing season. And further, the DEP is requiring that someone needs to be hired to inspect the site in terms of maintenance and monitoring of the restoration plan. And they have also recommended the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District as someone that they would approve, or some other third party which they have to approve. So it might be easier, since both the town and the DEP have selected this agent, that if that can be worked out, it would be probably the shortest route for the applicant. Third, it appears that the DEP has required that there will be no use of the emergency access road until the wetlands on either side are revegetated and the access road has been constructed. So they don't want any other access on that road until then. It also appears that the alternate building envelope on Lot 4 has been approved, and that the HET 200 form for the septic system for that building envelope has been approved. They have requested, and they've also approved the concept of the alternate location depending on which building envelope on Lot 4 is used. The only other potential conflict that I see here is that excuse me, they're requiring immediately the installation of at least one locking gate, and on the plans that the town has, there isn't a locking gate shown, but rather a chain and post detail. So I don't know if the DEP would consider a chain and post to not be in compliance with their order. But I think that's the high points.
Any other issues, Mr. Frinsco?
No, I just comment that the reading the order in its entirety, I came to the conclusion what the DEP wants to do is to prevent the use of the emergency access road for general construction purposes at this time and for emergency access. Obviously, there has to be access to that area to do the wetlands restoration that needs to be done. The second, our understanding that the chain and post, it is a locked chain and post, will satisfy that requirement. A gate consisting of two posts and a chain with a lock on it is the same thing as a locking gate, in our judgment. In any event, we will proceed to avoid having a conflict here. We'll proceed to implement the order. If there's anything else in there that our understanding of paragraph 3 is it references the exact plans which was submitted by date and plan number, incorporating those plans into the order. That's the one area where it's hard to read that sentence.
Could you just read that sentence as you understand it? Starting with the beginning of, just read that.
The emergency access road will be constructed in accordance with the details shown on, and then there's a list of those plans revised through, I think it's 42793. And then it goes on, or the set of plans referenced in finding two, okay, which are the subdivision plan itself.
Okay. Well, in the interest of speeding us along, comments, questions from the board?
Be helpful.
Judy.
I guess my first question would be for Maureen. We've seen in our memos for several months now the business about the right-of-way and drainage easement deeds of, I guess, the previous phases or the first phases. What is the history of why we were requiring this now? I seem to remember you said there were some problems with getting signed deeds or something, but I don't know.
It's not unusual. Some boards will require these deeds right up front before the road is even under construction. Sometimes what this board usually does is doesn't really look at the right-of-way deeds. It lets the council take care of that. These were requested because at earlier this year, the applicant refused to provide warranty deeds for the council to consider at more than one council meeting, and also suggested that they would like to have the road converted to a private road rather than a public road. Subsequently, the applicant has provided an acceptable right-of-way deed for Jordan Farm Road up to the entire part of the road in Phase 1A, and the town council has accepted that portion of road. That's why the deeds were requested at this time. The drainage easement deeds are deeds we usually get as part of any regular approval.
Do you know if what Mr. Frinsco says about having come to some agreement or having satisfied this with the town attorney? Mr. True. Have you talked to the town attorney?
Yeah, my understanding, well, the deeds were submitted to the town attorney on May 12th, which is 2 weeks after the submission deadline. And the board does not have copies of those. They went directly to the attorney. I think the main problem is that the applicant submitted quitclaim deeds on the roads, and it is standard practice to get a warranty deed, and that is what the applicant submitted on Phase 1A, was a warranty deed. So, I mean, the easiest thing to do would be to take the warranty deed for Phase 1A and substitute the survey descriptions for the 1A, for the 1B, and the 2A roads.
So if this has not been met right now, it is something that would be easily addressed by the applicant?
Yes, and it could also be addressed. It's something that's specific enough that it could be addressed through a condition on any approval.
Okay. On the comment number 3, engineering revisions, and I don't remember what the town engineer's comment was about areas 1, 2, and 3 in the January 20th submittal by the applicant for the wetlands restoration plan does have a map at the back, a very reduced site plan that shows areas 1, 2, and 3. Do you think the engineer was wanting to see those on our larger plan so he could clearly identify where the plantings were going?
That's my understanding. I think he was expecting to see 1, 2, and 3 to be put on the scale drawings that we have, and he's also asking to the identification, the locations of the new plantings.
Within each area.
That's right.
On your comment number 4 about the wetland restoration monitoring, Mr. Frinsco, I was unable in this short time to find any sort of contract with Ross Cudlitz, handwritten or otherwise, and
let me address two of your questions at the same time. I think Mr. Hill's letter went to the planner with respect to the deed.
Yes,
and,
but I didn't.
And number two, I know that Mr. Swan has given a copy of that contract to the town.
I don't know if I've seen that.
You received it this evening, and it's I received it at 3:30 this afternoon. The question is, I think what the board was asking for and what I was deeply hoping to receive was a very clear commitment on behalf of the applicant that could be enforced, that talked about a schedule of the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District coming and monitoring and making sure that the plan as approved would actually be implemented. I was envisioning something very similar to the schedule that was set up last fall with the Gramsci wetland alteration permit, where there was a note added to the plan that required that, in that case, there was a requirement that the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District would come onto the site in the fall, would write up a report and submit it to the code enforcement officer, would then have a follow-up visit in the spring and have another report, and that that further items that would have to be addressed would be done at that time. And I don't believe that anything like that would make it very clear for the code enforcement officer and the applicant of exactly what was expected to be done and when. I don't think that has been submitted.
Stepping backwards on the cost, well, I guess, no, it's going forward on the performance guarantee. We have seen something, I guess, from Stephen Moore on March 30th, talking about cost of plantings. I have so many things in front of me. I don't remember if I did see something from John Swan.
Again, the same thing you received this evening. Has the numbers on it. Is the breakdown of costs that we've received, and it is standard practice for any estimate to be broken down for the engineer. If it's not broken down, it just costs the town more money because it takes him a lot longer to review it.
Okay, I would certainly like to see this stuff in front of us with a little more review time. It looks all very reasonable as long as perhaps some sort of specific schedule and methodology for monitoring is established. I'd like Mr. Frinsco to go over what I think I finally assume is what you're seeking approval for tonight. The road is being relocated as currently built and shown on the plans. Lot 4 septic system is being relocated? Is that
right? Alternate.
An alternate. Okay. The gate is proposed to be relocated if the lot owners on 4 wish it to be so. You've got two locations.
As the board asked, we gave you alternate 1 and alternate 2.
Okay. There are proposed changes to the entrance landscaping, which another question I didn't ask is, the only place we see that is part of a January 4th memo. It's not on the plans either, is
There's
it?
There's an 8.5 by 11
right
sheet.
Here.
That's it.
And then associated with some of these things that we're approving a wetlands restoration plan and an associated monitoring schedule. Does that sound
Yes, ma'am.
Like
and
it?
The timing of that is really your decision. The amount to be placed in the performance guarantee is your decision. We've made suggestions to you. I don't think it's a problem in terms of working it out. We want to commence the work immediately. If there's a deadline, if there's stages you want deadlines on, I don't think that's a problem.
As one board member, again, I would feel more comfortable voting on final approval to see conditions drawn up by our attorney and finding the facts drawn up by the town attorney. I would certainly want to see a more detailed monitoring schedule and reporting, whatever's involved in that, that the town and DEP or whoever agrees that it's appropriate. Ideally, I would love to see the proposed landscaping plans on the plan itself as well as those areas 1, 2, and 3 delineated. I don't know how practically you can show the location of specific wetland plants in a restored area. I think
Very
you'd have
to
see
do.
The site, but I'd like to you to give it your best attempt, and I hope the town engineer would agree with your reason.
Perhaps John could reproduce on, probably on one of the construction drawings would be better, the boundaries shown on the wetlands plan, if that would be helpful, area 1, 2, and 3.
It's very hard on the 8.5, 11.
I understand
You just
that.
Have a line. And aside from, you know, clearing up the right-of-way drainage easement deeds, that sort of thing, I guess those are my only concerns.
And the applicant has accepted the proposal of Ross Cutlass of the Soil and Water Conservation District, which we understand is also acceptable to DEP.
Okay. Perhaps if it were a little more fleshed out to make town staff more comfortable with what
sure.
they expect to see reported and when.
Well, I don't know about the reporting. I guess that's whatever you folks want. I'm sure that Ross is most cooperative in reporting to town, so the scope of that would be up to you folks.
I would suggest perhaps you talk to the town planner or whoever on town staff and come up with a proposal that we can look at and approve, because we would have a difficult time establishing a schedule up here.
I think we would too, to be honest with you. Probably his schedule.
I'm sorry. There must be within his purview, there must be standard practices for seating deadlines and when he would want to monitor the first catch and so forth, and I'd look to see that developed in accordance to standard practice.
And in fact, the letter I got this afternoon, he pretty much lays that out. So I think there's certainly enough here to just firm it up in a clear way.
That's fine.
Sorry, Judy.
No, that's fine. That's all, Mr. Chair.
Tom?
I'm glad Judy went first. I've had the disadvantage of having missed several meetings, and I think Judy's covered all of my concerns. The only question I would have of the applicant is, We have a revised recording plat that shows Phase 1A, and I see where the a 30-foot drainage easement has been added to Lot 5. And if I go to the title block, I see revisions 1 through 6 listed with the dates, corresponding dates. And above that, I see approved by the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. I would suspect that this recording plat is at the registry, and this title block for the Planning Board signatures is already signed and it's dated.
If you're looking at the plan that's before you, which is the amended plan, that has not been signed yet because it hadn't been approved yet and hasn't been reduced to a linen yet. The original plan has been recorded, and I don't know if I have a copy of that with me this evening or not.
What I'm getting at is I would assume that the, let me just backtrack a minute, the plan that we've already signed looks just like this one, except for the change in dates. Let me ask the applicant, would it not be advisable to somehow flag those revisions that are dated and put a little triangle with a revision number within those?
I've never seen that done, but I'll have to ask, and I've looked at a lot of plans, but I can ask the engineer.
It's done commonly on construction documents.
It has been done on the associated plan submitted with the application.
All I'm getting at is that I see Phase 2A down the road here and B and C, and I'm already lost, and we're not out of Phase 1A yet, and I know how to read a drawing. It's just a very complicated process. And I think unless we develop a way of carefully monitoring revisions, we're going to be lost in no time here. And we're also going to lose a historic benefit of the board. The board will be turning over on alternating periods every 3 years.
Well, I guess what we have to look at is all of the revisions that are noted come prior to final approval of the plan, which has been recorded, Mr. Embry.
Would you state that again, please?
The noted revisions, I think, on what you're looking at, and I confess I'm not with you side by side, but it's the one that's unsigned.
That's correct.
Okay. It says it constitutes a revision to the previously recorded plan, Book 77, page 2.
That's right. 83.
Okay.
I think, if John, I might, the only revision to the recording plat from the one that was previously signed is revision number 10, dated 4/29/93, added drainage easement on Lot 5. And that revision is to the left of the title block.
Oh, okay.
I believe revision 9, 12/291, was part of the previously recorded plan. So the only change we've made to this recording plat is revision 10.
Now, there has been some changes made to the detailed plans which accompany this application, which are also before the board.
Yeah, that's complicated enough. This is something that has more common usage.
The recording plat would not change with the exception of the added drainage easement.
How would I know that? I would take the two plans and I'd compare them and I'd see which one had the most revisions on it and I'd check the most current date.
What you'd do is you'd look at the recorded plan, a copy of which is in your possession, and you would note that the change in accordance with engineering practice is listed adjacent to the title block. Anything after recording would be on the new one, and it's revision 10. Revision 9 is recorded. Revision 10 is what's being proposed to you, and the only thing revised is the added drainage easement on Lot 5.
And where do I find on this plan, just to help me and help us all get through this quickly, where do I find the date of the originally recorded plan?
You don't.
I have to have the other plan in front of me to
know
that.
Yes, I do.
Now, we can make reference, if you'd like, indicating on this recording plat that this supersedes plan dated book and page so-and-so.
That's actually pretty standard for this board.
I mean, that's not a problem at all to do that.
Yeah. Would you please do that?
Sure.
Surely.
That's
Any
it.
Else?
No. Peter? Mark?
I have no comments. Any other discussion? Seeing none, do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted in the application of Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channel View Road be tabled to the regular June 1993 meeting of the Planning Board.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as stated, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote. See you on our June meeting. Third Tuesday. 15th. And if I can find my agenda, we will get to the last order of business. We're close to the triple order witching hour tonight. Order of new business, Young Public Access Waiver request by Harold and Mary Young for public access for two lots off Sawyer Road, public access waiver section 19-4-2B, zoning ordinance. If the applicant or a representative of the applicant could come to the podium, introduce yourself and give us a brief description of what you're proposing.
Harold Young, Sawyer Road. And what I'd like to have is a public access waiver to sell two lots off from Fickett Street. Both these lots are under contract at the present time. I own approximately 121 acres there right now, and these are going to be 2 3-acre lots. And it's hard enough to give up the lots, and it's even harder to be in front of the planning board tonight. So I don't know what you want for
questions. As much or as little as you'd like. If you feel comfortable leaving it that, we'll simply move into discussion and questions. If you want to tell us a little bit about the land and what you're proposing.
Well, I farmed the land all of my life. I've owned it since 1976, and through family circumstances, I have had to give up farming. I worked for the town for over 20 years. I worked for Public Works Department. I worked there 6 years full-time. And to hang on to it, to be honest with you, to pay my taxes, I've got to sell a couple lots. So that's just about the size of it right there.
Okay. I'll start the discussion, number one, by giving some parameters. The public access waiver application has few guidelines, and it's up to the board what you'd like to discuss first in order whether the dealing with the completeness of the plan submitted to us. Can jump right into discussion of the plan that was submitted. Can start to ask questions. I guess I'll open it up for the wishes of the board. They're all waiting for somebody else to go
Mr.
first.
Chairman?
Yes, Tom.
since I'm all rested up from my absences, I'll go first. I have always found this public access waiver issue to be peculiar. It's on the books. That's a moot issue. I think of it in terms of access to lots which otherwise are inaccessible to a public way. And I'm very concerned and have discussed in the past what happens with the idea of flag lots and uncontrolled subdivision. I think in farming parlance, what we're talking about here is we're cutting the first leg off the cow or off the pig.
I understand that. Well,
to feed the rest of it.
And excuse me, but I cannot lie to you and say that I'll guarantee you, this gentleman here won't be in front of you. It'll be a developer. But I cannot say that it will not happen.
Okay.
I would like to say that, but I cannot say that.
I appreciate your honesty. And based on that, I'm really wondering if there is a need at this point to have a public access waiver, why the lots aren't configured differently so that you have access, either have access from Fickett Street or provide a 50-foot wide right-of-way into the site with the probability that the site will probably be expanded in the future. And I guess that's my greatest concern, is that we will have two houses developed, we'll have a private way, and we'll have a lot of pressure for probably future subdivision. This will now be your fourth lot that you've cut from your property, is that
exactly
correct?
The other, yes, two were frontage. That I meant the requirements of 200 feet frontage for, mm-hmm, each of them.
And those pre-existed a time such that we don't have to go through subdivision,
exactly,
with these other two.
Exactly, 6 years ago. Right.
I don't have the answers, but those are my concerns. I just driving down Fickett Street and all of a sudden seeing this road sort of take off into the field, and right, two houses sitting out in the middle of the field with no relationship to anything else. It's with no criticism of your situation or your approach. I'm not sure I'd do anything differently if I were in your shoes. But right, as a planning board member, I'm just concerned about sort of the disorganized and sporadic development that could occur on this site, and I guess I'd like to see a better planned approach. And I'll use as an example, as you come into the site with this right-of-way, there's this enormous wedge shape piece that goes all the way back to Fickett Road that I just can't understand why it's there, and that's sort of what I would use as a basis of my concerns about the general layout and approach to development.
Okay.
I would suggest, as a minimum, I don't see why there can't be a 50-foot right-of-way into the site, and that the road can't be set up for, if you don't intend to do it tomorrow or within 5 years, but certainly some expectation that this thing is going to have a longer range effect, okay, on your property.
I firmly don't care for a 50-foot right-of-way, because you're talking about opening up the road. To me, a 50-foot right-of-way, as it stands now, there's just going to be a 30-foot right-of-way, mm-hmm, there, and that cuts a minimum of trees. And to go back in the past, oh, probably 5 years ago, when the town decided to put their superhighway through there, I thought I was back in Vietnam again when I saw that road when I came home. Yeah. And if I'd have known what I know today, Mr. McGovern would not have got my signature on that land. It would have been by eminent domain, and, mm-hmm, I'll guarantee you it wouldn't have happened, because the economies went to hell enough, so I know it wouldn't have happened. It's a road that goes nowhere. I was very upset with it. And I'm still upset with it, and I apologize for getting onto that. But you talk about what a road would look like. I remember what Fickett Street did look like. And before the development went down through there with them wheelers and ruined that road, that's neither here nor there either. Mm-hmm. So I guess we can have
those are my initial comments.
And I can understand
that's
that.
All
I appreciate it.
I will offer that.
I do not want to. I don't want to drive down Fickett Street and have a 50-foot right-of-way that I can see clear down the end of my property. It is a beautiful place up, yeah, there. Ms. O'Meara has been up there, and she'll agree with that. And
yeah, the board has discussed that issue in the past, and we are trying to get this requirement,
right,
to clear the entire right-of-way,
right,
scrapped from our design standards. So when we state a 50-foot right-of-way, we're not implying that we expect to have the entire,
okay,
right-of-way cleared.
Okay.
That's it.
Other comment? Judy?
Mr. Young, not knowing why you're coming for us or the total size of your property, that's the first impression I had, is that this would have tremendous future subdivision potential. And I thought that if that were the case, it would be very logical. You'd have a road. Is this, I always get turned around, Sawyer down here?
Fickett's right here.
Well, down here somewhere?
I think Sawyer's at the top of the map, isn't it?
Let me think. Excuse me.
One of the maps showed, oh,
yeah,
I think
Sawyer
it was.
Would be down.
I have a larger map of the whole property, but I just...
I guess looking, there's something in Al Frick's report. It seemed quite likely that if something did happen, I understand you wouldn't be proposing that this road would conceivably curve through the property and come out on Sawyer Street. And that's why I would echo Mr. Emery's concern about,
yes,
having
and
some
50-foot
right-of-way.
I can appreciate that.
It would be nice, perhaps, if you could research with town staff, and I'm not really averse at all to having a narrower pavement width and reducing standards, assuming the town engineer goes along with that, but to have the 50-foot right-of-way to preserve the town's interest, to I guess, step back, what I'd hate to see is if this does become before the board one day as a future subdivision.
Right.
That perhaps this logical link would not be able to happen because there's a substandard right-of-way, or the people who buy these two lots say, I bought it with the understanding this would always be a dead end. And you have some development that's not at all connected.
Yeah.
I can appreciate you're not wanting a large road or a lot of clearance, but if there was any way that just to have that on the face of the earth or in a legal document to preserve that from a good planning point of view, I would favor that. I also, it looks like from the memo we got that it was unclear about your proposal on how this road would be paved and the grade and the radiuses and so forth. Is that something that you can clarify for the town engineer?
It's going to be 18-foot wide gravel road with a 50-foot, if that is what the town wants, a 50-foot paved from the town line, from the road, 50 feet. And the grade, I've been assured by the person that's putting the road in, will meet the 2%.
Perhaps, Maureen, you could indicate what the town engineer is actually looking for to receive from Mr. Young that we haven't received.
I have spoken with Mr. Young yesterday, and I think we agreed that in his mind he has decided how he's going to construct the road, and what we need is for him to put it on the plan so that it's clear to everyone how he's going to do it. It sounds like there aren't going to be a lot of conflicts in terms of what our requirements are and what the town engineer and the board has been used to receiving in the past, but that we just need to see these things on the plan.
And can I assume from either you or Mr. Young that to plot building envelopes or the proposed location of the septic systems, is that straightforward? Is that could be done, because I, as one
yes,
board
it is.
Member,
oh, yes.
I'd feel better seeing it on the plan than having to look at different
okay.
documents.
It's just, I've spent more money than what I have, to be honest with you, just to get
yeah.
here. See what I'm saying? And
I can appreciate
I'm not
that.
A developer, like I said, and I don't mean to bring my private life into this, but I'm not doing this because I want to. I'm doing it because I have to. So.
I guess that's it.
Other comments? Steve, Mark? Here, Bob.
The only other comment I have, Steve, is I don't see evidence of the distance from Sawyer Street intersection to Fickett Street, and that's probably, and maybe the town engineer is asking for that in his information in terms of site distance.
Excuse me, I didn't mean to. I have a letter here from Bob Malley, and it is well over the 300 feet from the intersection of Fickett and Sawyer, and it would be well over 300 feet to the South Portland line. You probably don't have that letter. I apologize for that.
That's right. And the driveway is staked. It appears it says on the HHE 200 form that there's a 50-foot right-of-way staked, as staked in field. It says a proposed 50-foot right-of-way is staked in
yeah,
field.
Originally I was going to go with a 50-foot mm-hmm. right-of-way. And then I decided I did not want to come in front of you people, think that I was going to develop this whole parcel of land. Yeah. I wanted to keep something simple. You see what I'm saying? I wanted more or less just
yeah.
a dirt road. I can sell two lots. I've got 1,000 feet of frontage left. I can sell if worse comes to worse. I'm just here to try to do the right thing for the future of the town, because someday I won't be around and it probably will be developed. But.
Assuming we table this action tonight, I would also request a tax map. I think that's probably the easiest thing that would show the entire whole.
I have a map right here of the whole parcel,
okay.
If you would like to see it.
Yeah, that would be not, I don't want to see it now.
No, but I'm saying
yeah.
I do have.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think Judy's comments in terms of grading, the planning board is often put in a difficult position, whether it's daycare centers or applicants. We understand that not everyone is out to be a developer and their very personal needs. On the other hand, there's a public interest, people who have flooded basements who end up in wetlands that don't realize they're in wetlands, and those mm-hmm. sorts of concerns. How can we get around this issue of the grades? It seems to me that one of the better approaches would be to have a site walk. I don't know if anybody else on the board is interested in that.
It certainly came to my mind. I mean, we're open for whatever procedure you'd like to do, and I think If we're anticipating tabling for 1 month, that would be a natural thing to have a site walk.
Now, another thing, I know this is none of your concern, but both of these lots are under contract, and one of these contracts I will lose because of, you know, I'm not blaming you people, but I'm just saying this is a position it has put me in, so I'm more or less starting over again, so.
Any other questions? I would say the issue of you said that you do have a map of the whole site, and
yes, I
do. Understand starting from scratch, not knowing the lot, and
I can appreciate. I'll guarantee
in most cases not having driven there since we received the
right.
The packet, and most of us know the area and sort of generally remember it. It's difficult to actually, in our minds, place this on the face of the earth.
Yes, I can understand that.
There are some issues with public safety issues. Have you talked with the fire chief?
Yes, I have.
The radius and turning a vehicle into
this? Yes, I have. Yes, I have. There was no problem with one turnaround for both of those.
I guess more of interest to me, the turnaround on the Hammerhead is important, but also the radius coming off from Fickett into this driveway, whatever vehicle
right.
they have to. It looks like there's a sharp angle to come right. by. Why did you choose not to bring that to a right angle to Fickett Street, to the driveway?
Well, to be honest with you, just for the way it would look, I thought it would look out of place on Fickett Street. You see what I'm saying? If you came out from my land going, it would more or less, the driveway would be more or less headed up the Fickett Street, up towards the South Portland line. And the slope of that hill is
That's a difficult thing. The piece of land, and then I can't even imagine where I am along that stretch right now.
Me.
But when you see a new plan and it's not coming out perpendicular to the other street, when ordinances
right.
tend to dictate that
right.
they should be at right angles, you wonder. The lot that's Downing and Hallig.
Downing Hague, yes.
Hague, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
I have my bifocals on. I can't
That's
see
right.
it. The southerlymost site. Is that occupied by a house now?
No, there's no house
there.
On there? Or neither one of those. No.
Is 10-foot setback from a property line a requirement of public access?
For a road?
Hmm.
The driveway 10-foot setback comes out of the site plan regulations. And in the past, the code enforcement officer has only applied that in site plan approvals.
I guess that's an issue. If we could visit the site and at least have the center line staked, it would be obvious then either why we should or why we shouldn't
mm-hmm.
consider, number one, an access road that doesn't come out at a right angle. Number two, why it abuts immediately to the neighboring site without any setback and a butter.
Just for clarification, is that 10 feet to the right-of-way line or to the paved edge?
The 10-foot setback?
Yeah, mm-hmm. that's required under site plan.
From the property line.
From the property line to the right-of-way line of the road or to?
From the property line to the actual road.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Under the site plan regs, you can't put a driveway closer than 10 feet to the property line unless you're sharing the driveway with the abutting property owner.
So if we have a 50-foot right-of-way here, perhaps even with a 30-foot right-of-way, we could meet that criteria, the way the plan's drawn up.
I guess one thing that I would like to see is a written letter from the fire chief as to the turning radius entering this access from Fickett.
Mm-hmm.
What we're trying to circumvent, going back to the planning, or to the drawing board and doing all the radius work and so forth. But I think if it's acceptable to the
to
town
the
emergency
okay.
Vehicles, then I think that may be acceptable. Any other questions, comments? Seeing none, do I hear a motion?
Steve, just a second. What does a planning board, this is a draft document, I would assume, Maureen, what does he have to bring to the town in order to get approval? Does he have to have something that's either signed or I guess there's a draft deed here, isn't it?
In the past, the board has not signed public access waiver plans, but what you do have to do is there has to be some recording of the plan because it restricts future landowners to what they can do in terms of their access. So what you've done in the past is there's been some kind of recording that references the plan and the plan has gone with it, but the plan itself doesn't have to be signed.
The plan has gone to the registry with the deed.
Right.
Any other comment? Motion?
I just guess my hope, Mr. Young, is it looks like we are moving toward a sidewalk and a tabling, is that you can work with the town engineer, since it was his concerns mainly that are noted in what we're looking at here, to come back with something that meets his concerns, because I don't have a concern with what you're doing, but I would like to have it all in form. I'd hate to have to send you back again. I can appreciate your concern about the money you spend on this project and wasting time.
Yeah.
But I would really encourage you to contact Maureen and the town engineer to get it.
Okay, so you're saying I can get the help I need through the town engineer. Am I right or
well,
wrong?
Well, or through the town planner to...
Maureen, I'm not saying Maureen. I'm talking... Yeah, right.
I think what Mr. Young is asking is if the town engineer will draw up the plans for him.
I assume not.
No.
That's what I'm saying. How much more is this going to basically cost me? Could you tell me that? I mean...
Can you...
Oh, I have no idea how much it costs to hire someone. The only suggestion I would make is that my experience is if you hire someone who's familiar with this process and get them to do everything at once, it's less expensive in the long run because you don't have to keep repeating the copies of all the plans. But for anyone who's come to the board with a public access waiver request, there is an initial expense.
I assume the town engineer could give Mr. Young a definite idea of exactly what he needs to see and perhaps minimally see in this case.
In effect, actually, the ordinance is very specific about the minimum standards, and certainly we would be giving him guidance as to ranges within those standards that he could approach, and I think I've already talked to him about some of those items.
Okay, my only comment on that is someone who's not familiar with this process reading the ordinance could have a lot of confusion with what's being asked when you talk about turning radiuses and so forth. As long as it's very clear what the ordinance reads, sometimes ordinances are written for different audiences, if you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
One other question. Are you actually going to construct the road, or are the lot owners going to construct the road?
I'm having someone construct
okay.
it. Right, exactly. Because I want to maintain four, if there was future. I didn't want to cut myself off up back there. I mean, I could sell 200 feet of frontage there, and I wouldn't have to be here. You see
mm-hmm.
what I'm saying?
Sure.
So, and right about now, I wish I had done that. So, but that's neither here nor there.
Or you could sell 250 feet of frontage and keep a 50-foot right-of-way.
Exactly. It's very frustrating, believe me.
Well, we do this in the interest in the department with which you used to be employed, so.
Yeah, I understand
that.
I am still employed, believe me. So. But, you know.
Any other comment?
No.
Questions?
Do we talk about a sidewalk prior to a motion for tabling?
We can.
I agree with Mr. Emery. It would be a very good idea.
Sure. What's a good date? Saturday mornings?
Can't be this weekend.
Can't be this weekend. How about a week weekday evening?
That's
trying
fine.
To get around schedules of softball games and
yeah, I don't have
baseball
a schedule.
Do you want to do the how about the night of the Knicks workshop?
That's a great idea.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
That's June 1st.
June 1.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a Tuesday evening.
How does that work with submission deadlines if we had any concerns at that point?
It's after the submission deadline.
Do we typically come up with concerns that we would direct an applicant to submit something?
Sometimes. Do you want to do
it?
What
does it have to be done to meet the submission deadline?
It's the last, I believe it's March, May 28th is the submission deadline.
How about next Tuesday then?
Fine with me.
Next Tuesday evening?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Like 5:30, 5:45, 6.
Can everybody make it at 5:30, 5:45, 6 on Tuesday?
I think so.
as long as we don't get a nasty letter from someone saying that we didn't try hard to work this process through quickly.
We're always open to...
Not to drag up old mud or anything. That's fine.
Why don't we shoot for 5:30?
That date is...
5:30 on Tuesday.
May 25th.
May 25th. And is that okay with you, Mr. Young?
Yeah.
To meet us there? Perhaps if you could be right at that corner where the proposed access road is with a pink hat on or something.
With bells on.
With bells on, okay. That's one way. We'll go by your ears.
And you can probably park just right there on Fickett Street on either side. There's a,
it's wide enough.
There's a
certainly.
Shoulder.
Oh, yes. It's very wide. It super highway, no problem.
We do have, we don't have a motion before us. Do I hear a motion? We have settled on a sidewalk date, Tuesday the 25th at 5:30. Be there or be square. Stephen.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Harold and Mary Young for public access waivers for two lots to be created off Sawyer Road be tabled to the regular June planning board meeting, with a site walk to be done May 25th at 5:30.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second. One comment. Should that be Fickett Road?
Fickett Street.
Fickett Street instead of off of Sawyer Road, be off of Fickett Street.
Thank you. Seconded with that one amendment. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. We'll see you Tuesday evening at 5:30,
okay.
And hopefully again next
hope
month.
So.
Thank you very much. That's our last agenda item. I don't want to drag the evening on at all. I just want to make one comment. I will open up first for other business. Any other business to come before the board? My only one issue of other business is the first agenda item this evening. Was a difficult agenda item to go over, and I, just as the chair of the planning board, I want to express my feelings to the planning board members. I think we handled the agenda item correctly. I know that we didn't make some people happy. There are times when we simply don't, and no matter what we do, it never looks like the planning board is doing it correctly, and that always a difficult situation to be put in. I guess just as the chair, I want to say that I think we did handle it correctly, and I hope the applicant will be back. That's the only comment I want to make. Any other business?
Well, I'd just like to reinforce that comment. It seemed to me that someone who's in business and has as many businesses, and I know what and I said this 3 or 4 meetings ago, I know what an ice cream cone costs, that a week was as good as a nod to a blind horse, and had the applicant brought together the materials that were requested that long time ago, I don't think any of the problems that evolved would have evolved, and they would have had approval by now.
Concur. Do I hear a motion to adjourn the meeting?
So moved.
Seconded? Those in favor? Meeting is adjourned. Thank you.